This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
I'm Rita Redberg, one of the co-chairs and a cardiologist at UCSF, and I'm very pleased to introduce tonight our speaker, who is Jeff Tice, who's an associate professor of medicine at UCSF. He did his training, his internal medicine residency at UCSF, and then did a two-year fellowship in building interdisciplinary research careers in women's health, Career Development Award. And he also has done a lot of research related to what we're going to hear about tonight on diet and nutrition, including the modeling of the potential impact of lowering homocysteine through diet or vitamin B supplements on heart disease. He was also the principal investigator of a trial of a randomized trial of phytoestrogens, which come from red clover, to treat menopausal symptoms. You know, there's been a lot of interest in treating menopausal symptoms with things other than estrogen. And he's also conducted a randomized trial of soy for breast cancer prevention. He gives regular talks on the clinical evidence for the use of vitamin and supplements to improve health. And I will say I'm really looking forward to your talk because I've known Jeff for many years because he also does the evidence reviews for the California Technology Assessment Forum, and they are uniformly the most thorough and comprehensive and easy-to-follow evidence reviews. So without further ado, I'm going to turn the mic over to Jeff Tice to talk to us about vitamins and supplements.
Great. Thanks, Rita, and thanks to everybody for coming. Hopefully, this is of interest, I've already gotten a number of questions from folks before the talk, so I'm happy to answer questions. As part of this, they videotape this, so they really prefer me not to take questions during the talk, but hopefully we'll have plenty of time afterwards. But I want to start with a question. How many of you take at least one vitamin or supplement right now? All right, so almost everybody in the room. That's pretty typical. So I have no conflicts of interest. As you heard from Rita, I have done some research in this area, but I guess the phytoestrogen supplement research was actually funded by the manufacturer of that supplement. But if you go look that up when it was published in sister publication, JAMA, it was a completely negative trial. So I didn't find anything supportive of phytoestrogens, much to the company's chagrin. So I don't think that ends up presenting any significant conflicts either. I'm an internist. I prescribe pills. So there's been a lot of interest, and I was interested in this from the beginning of my training. Are there elements of a healthy diet that we can concentrate in a pill and maybe actually do more than even the healthy diet? So I've been interested in this topic for a long time. And of course, it's very popular with the public. There are things in the popular press all the time. Vitamin D increases longevity, or vitamin supplements are associated with an increased risk of death. 20 supplements and vitamins to increase longevity, and so on. It's all over the map. And I'm hopefully, one of the goals of this talk from my perspective is to educate you a little bit about how to think about all of these studies coming out and when to really pay attention and when maybe just to say, oh, another thing like that, maybe I'll keep watching the literature but not get too caught up in it. So today I'm going to cover a couple of things. So I'm happy to answer questions as best I can at the end about other supplements and vitamins. I'm going to start with the antioxidants. That was the class of vitamins. It was very popular when I trained in the early 1990s, early to mid 1990s. All of our cardiologists were putting patients on antioxidants. There was lots in the press. And I actually gave my third year talk at the end of the third year of residency. Most of us give a big talk at Grand Rounds, and I gave mine on, mostly on the antioxidant vitamins. And I think that story is really instructive, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit to start off with. Then turn to folic acid and the B vitamins, which lower homocysteine. And homocysteine, we know, is associated with mostly heart attacks and strokes. And so I'm going to talk about that literature. And as you've heard, I've done some research in that area. Then we'll turn to vitamin D and calcium, still very controversial, very much in the news these days. And then to the omega-3 fatty acids. I mean, these are the things that are most commonly taken among our patients. But again, this is a huge topic. We could have a week-long series of seminars on vitamins and supplements. So I'm just curious, what just as a brief question, how many Americans regularly use vitamin supplements? In this room, it was 81 to 100%, but what do people think? 0 to 20%? No, shaking head. 21 to 40%? 41 to 60%? Some there. 61 to 80%? And then 81 to 100%? All right, or this room. It's at least in about 2011, I think was the last numbers I saw, it was about 52%, and that was up from 26% in the 1970s, so it had doubled since then, and so it's probably a little bit higher. The last financial numbers that I could find, for this is just for vitamin supplements, multivitamins and vitamins, not the other supplements, was about $9.4 billion, and that was 7 years ago. And I think it's important. The headlines that I pulled were mostly from observational studies, and these kind of studies are really popular. You always see them in the Chronicle, and the New York Times, and the Wall Street Journal. But I'm just highlighting, these are observational studies usually, and these are things where you see an association. You see people who take more of these vitamins or have higher levels of these vitamins get less of this cancer, get less colds and flus and things like that. But observation is not causality. It's an association. And people who take supplements usually are more educated. People like you coming here, as you say, interested in learning. And they're more physically active. They're more likely to eat a healthy diet to begin with. They're thinner. Less likely to smoke, less likely to have diabetes, they have lower blood pressure. So all these things contribute to living longer, to being healthier, to having less cancer and things like that. And again, that makes it hard to tease out in observational studies, is it this vitamin level or this vitamin that people are taking that's causing this good health outcome? Or is it the fact that just people who eat a healthy diet, who take vitamin supplements, they're just healthier to begin with. They have a healthier lifestyle factors overall, and that's really what we're measuring and not a true effect of the vitamin. And the only way really to test it is to do an experiment, a randomized trial, and that's sort of the methodologic take-home point that I want to make. These kinds of studies, these observational studies, should be what we talk about in science as hypothesis generating. They raise a really interesting possibility, but we need to do more to know for sure that association is causal, that the higher intake of a certain vitamin leads to less cancer, or less heart disease, and so on. And of course, I'm going to show you a number of examples where we've been fooled as scientists. And other reasons they're popular, I mean, just in the popular press, at the late 18th century, early 19th century, there were a lot of diseases of deficiency around. And the most popular one, of course, is scurvy, which went back actually to the 1700s. And it was actually the first randomized trial was done by the ship's doctor that actually showed that giving people vitamin C in the form of citrus fruits actually treated the scurvy. So clearly these are diseases of deficiency though, and it doesn't mean that Linus Pauling was right. So a little bit is good. You need a certain amount to be healthy, but does it make sense to give a whole lot more is one of the other questions, which of course that's the supersize me philosophy that's very popular in the United States as well. More is always better. So there are many examples of low levels of vitamin D leads to rickets in children and in adults as osteomalacia. So weak bones, because vitamin D is important. It actually gets turned into a hormone that tells the body when to absorb calcium and how much, and phosphorus is sort of key elements in building bone. And the other reason I think they're popular is this is something we can do without going to a doctor. We have some control over it, and people who are focused on health and prevention and want to do everything possible, and this seems like a great, inexpensive way to prevent disease and promote overall wellness. So these are the kind of things that patients report in surveys about why they use these. But as a physician, you know, my guiding principle when recommending something is first do no harm. And most of the time for vitamin therapy, we're not treating a deficiency. We're kind of promoting good health. And if I'm recommending that you take a chemical, a vitamin is a chemical. You know, I recommend you take a pill, spend money on this. If you're already healthy, I really should have the highest level of evidence. I should be really sure that the benefits of taking this pill outweigh the risks. And really to do that, we need randomized trials. I'm going to try and highlight the evidence from observational studies and contrast that with the findings in randomized trials. So the first story is the antioxidants. We still believe today that oxidative damage is really at the root of a lot of the diseases of aging, of cancer, of heart disease, of aging skin, the thinning and wrinkling, and the aging brain, the cognitive issues that we have as we get older, the weakening of the muscles. There's great basic science data, animal model data, to suggest that oxidative damage is at the root of a lot of that. And antioxidants help to sop up the free radicals, help to prevent that kind of damage. So it makes sense, and there was a lot of scientific evidence to suggest that, and there are also things that are provided by a healthy diet with just a variety of foods that Michael Pollan would suggest are good for us, just fresh fruits and vegetables. So beta-carotene is related to vitamin A, is one of the earliest well-studied antioxidant vitamins. It's found in a lot of red, yellow, and orange fruits and vegetables, like carrots and tomatoes and sweet potatoes and so on. It's important for vision. That's the vitamin A connection. It's important for the what we call cellular differentiation, moving from stem cells to the fully developed cells in the eye or the liver or the heart. It's important for immune function, and it's an important antioxidant. And it's pretty safe, really. Taking high doses of beta-carotene, people who eat a lot of carrots, they get a little yellow discoloration in the creases of their palms, but it wasn't thought to be harmful at all. And one of the things that was noted was that people who had high blood levels of beta-carotene tended to get less cancer, and in particular lung cancer. And as you know, it's the most common killer in the United States, and we haven't been very effective at treating it. So the idea of preventing lung cancer was very exciting. So this is one of three very large studies of beta-carotene, mostly to prevent lung cancer, that they also, there was thinking that it prevented heart disease as well. In this study, there were about 18, a little over 18,000 people at high risk for lung cancer. So mostly smokers, former smokers, folks exposed to asbestos. Ages 45 to 74, about a third were women. This was mostly done in the Seattle area, and the initial follow-up was for 4 years, though they've continued the follow-up over time. And they studied both beta-carotene and vitamin A. And just the bottom line here is that the active treatment, so those who got the beta-carotene, they died more often from anything, just overall, when you looked at all-cause mortality, death from any cause, the opposite of what was thought. They actually died more often than those who got the placebo, the identical placebo. They died more often from cardiovascular disease, and they got more lung cancer. So the exact opposite of what the investigators thought, based on observational studies, really well done observational studies, trying to account for all the healthy lifestyle things. So a complete shock when this came out. And I'm going to give just a brief, now I'm going to turn to vitamin E, which is another antioxidant vitamin, really the most important fat-soluble antioxidant vitamin. So vitamins are either fat-soluble, so they accumulate in our body and act in certain places and pass through cellular membranes easily, get into the brain and stuff, or water-soluble. This is a fat-soluble one, as is beta-carotene. Deficiency is rare. And I put the RDA here. This is how much we need. About 22 international units a day is enough for basic functions to prevent, harmful things like scurvy or rickets in kids. So this is, you need around 22 international units a day to be healthy. There are a lot of places we get vitamin E. It's fat soluble, so it's in fatty compounds, vegetable oil, egg yolks, nuts, and things like that. And this gives you a sense of where in the American diet we get our vitamin E. So this is an observational study, the Nurses' Health Study. This is a famous study. I see heads shaking. Many of you heard of the Nurses' Health Study. In this particular version of it, they looked at about 87,000 women who were healthcare providers, nurses mostly. They didn't have a history of prior heart disease, a prior stroke, or cancer. And they followed them for 8 years. So this is not a randomized trial. This is just observation. They asked them what they ate. They calculated how much vitamin E they took in. And they followed them over time for a number of different health outcomes. And here we divided up the amount of vitamin E that they took into five equal-sized groups. That's what a quintile is. So the lowest group, the lowest 20% of women, took in about 3 international units per day, at least as best they could calculate by asking their diet and doing very sophisticated analysis of the foods and figuring out how much vitamin E was in it. So about 3.8, and they used that as the comparison group. So that this relative risk is compared to this group. One means you have the same number of heart attacks and death from heart disease, in this case being the outcome. The people who ate the next most amount of vitamin E, they had about twice as much vitamin E, and they had about the same risk of heart attacks or death from heart disease. When you got up into the middle quintile, half of women had more, half of women had less, they saw a slight increase in the risk for heart attacks and strokes. And when you got up to the fifth quintile, so this is the 1/5 of women who have the most vitamin E intake, and you see the actual amount of vitamin E suddenly jumps up quite a bit from 17 international units a day all the way up to 200. So this group is clearly not just getting their vitamin E from food. They're getting 10 times what's recommended a day. So they're taking pill forms to get this much vitamin E. And you see they have the lowest risk for heart disease, heart attacks, and death from heart disease. So that relative risk of 0.66 means a 34% lower rate of heart attacks and death from heart disease. So we measure things with statistics, and we say a p-value, a probability of this happening due to chance of less than 5%, less than 0.05, is sort of the standard for believing that something is real in medicine. And here it was 0.001, so less than about a 1 in 1,000 chance that this was just a random finding. So we really believe that this is a true association. But it's an association. This is an observational study. So we don't know that it's causal. And to study really whether it's causal, we need to do a randomized trial. So this is one randomized trial of vitamin E, again in women, because remember the first study was the nurse's health study all in women. So this is a large study, 40,000 women, at least 45 years of age or older. And they were randomized to getting 600 international units of vitamin E every other day or an identical placebo. And they were randomized. They didn't know what they got. They got an identical looking pill, and they were followed for a long time, over 10 years in this trial, before we got an answer. And we found nothing, no benefit in terms of cancer. The relative risk was 1.01, which means, if anything, there was a tiny trend towards more. But really, no difference in cancer, no difference in terms of major cardiovascular events, meaning strokes and heart attacks. So completely null study. So the vitamin E, that benefit we saw in the observational study was probably just because healthier women were more likely to take that extra vitamin E. And that lower rate of strokes and heart attacks was just because they had overall healthier lifestyle and had nothing to do with the vitamin E. So there have been many, many studies of antioxidants. These are the results from 47 different randomized trials. So the experiments, not observational studies. Over 180,000 people agreed to be randomized, so contributed their health information altruistically, participated in these studies. And in these studies, there were, during the follow-up for the studies, over 25,000 people died. And that provided information on the risk of dying from any cause from a number of different antioxidant vitamins. And here's what they found. Vitamin A. 16% increase in death from the antioxidants. Beta carotene, 7% increase in total mortality. Vitamin E, 4%. Small, but there were enough numbers. We were so excited about vitamin E that they did a lot of studies. So that actually was statistically significant when you put all the information together. And even vitamin C, I didn't talk about it, but it's also an antioxidant. It's the primary water-soluble antioxidant. People think it's safe because essentially you pee it out every day. It doesn't accumulate. Fat-soluble vitamins accumulate in our body fat. So there's, you know, if it's harmful, there's some concern about that. And people thought, you pee this out, you just use what you need, and you get rid of it. But even there, wasn't statistically significant. We don't have as many big studies, but the trend was towards an increase in total mortality. So absolutely no benefit to these and likely harm. So these are vitamins that I discourage my patients from taking. I say, not only do I think the evidence is unclear, I think the evidence is clear, they're harmful. Don't take excess of these vitamins. And why might that be? Well, you know, the body is very sophisticated in the way it uses different things, and we use oxidative mechanisms. They're not just harmful, but the body uses them to kill bacteria, to kill cells that are sort of on their way to cancer. And so it may be, we don't really know why this happened, but it may be that when you flood the body with a lot of antioxidants, the net harms outweigh the benefits. But that's a hypothesis we don't know for sure. We just know the data are very clear that there are no benefits overall to taking large amounts of antioxidant vitamins. All right. So I put that out there just because there was a tremendous amount of basic science supporting the value of the antioxidant vitamins, tremendous amount of animal model data, there was good scientific rationale for it. There were observational human studies suggesting benefit. But when we did the randomized trials, there was no benefit, and in fact, for many of them, harm. So I just want you to keep that in mind when reading this literature, because there's always going to be new, exciting things that we find. I mean, I got very excited about the vitamins and homocysteine, and I'll show you. It's essentially the same story. We've known that homocysteine is a bad thing. There are certain genetic abnormalities that lead to huge builds up of homocysteine in the body. There's something called homocystinuria. There are a couple of different genetic abnormalities that lead this, and you get very high levels of homocysteine, like 100 to 400 micromoles per liter for the units, whereas normal is 8 to 12. So you and I, we live in the 8 to 12 normally. And it's pretty rare, one in 150,000 live births. And these people who have this, they have strokes and heart attacks by the time they're 30, about half of them. So a clear association with vascular disease. They also get blood clots, so it's in veins, not just arteries, so it's a little more complicated. And they get all these other things. They get osteoporosis early. There's a funny dislocation of the eye, of the lens in the eye. And they also often have cognitive problems. They can be developmentally delayed. And even without that, even in the normal range, we see an increased risk of total death in observational studies. So this is a study out of Sweden, I think. These were all people with heart disease. They all had a catheterization, a proven blockage in arteries to the heart, and they measured homocysteine. And those with the lowest homocysteine levels, less than 9, that's the referent group. So we're going to compare everybody to them. If you have modestly elevated homocysteine, 9 to 15, you were at a threefold increased risk of dying, not just from heart disease, for all causes. If you were even higher, 15 to 20, again, much lower than the homocystinuria, a little bit elevated compared to normal, sixfold increase. And if you were above 20, you had almost a tenfold increase in the risk of dying. Again, highly statistically significant. Observational study. This is not a randomized trial. Just go around, measure the levels of homocysteine. And it's easy to lower homocysteine. Bunch of randomized trials, again, because it's very exciting work, a lot of basic science to suggest why this should happen. Folic acid, cheap B vitamin, lowers homocysteine by 25%. Add some B12 in, you get additional 7%. You get about a 32%, 33%. You can reduce it by a third with, you know, things that really cost pennies per year if you didn't have all the marketing costs and everything else thrown in. So very exciting. Maybe we can prevent a whole lot of strokes and heart attacks by pills that are safe and cost pennies a day. So there have been a number of randomized trials. This was something published in JAMA Internal Medicine a number of years ago, where they actually got all of the data from 8 large trials, in this case a little over 37,000 patients, about 5,000 deaths, a bunch of other strokes and heart attacks, and a little over 3,000 cancers. And they lowered homocysteine. If you were randomized to the homocysteine lowering pill, it dropped by 25% compared to those who were randomized to no pill. In fact, everybody came down a little bit, in part because we thought this was so important. We were actually putting it, and we still do, we fortify flour and bread and stuff with folate now, in part because of this, more for something else that I'll come to. Once again, you saw no impact on total mortality, and in fact, no trend. The trend, if anything, was in the wrong direction. Not statistically significant. So a relative risk of 1 means relative to the people who didn't get the homocysteine, you had exactly the same rates of death, exactly the same rate of cardiovascular events, strokes and heart attacks, exactly the same effect, even a 5% increased risk in cancer. So absolutely no benefit. So the clearest message was it doesn't prevent cancer or heart disease. Again, many of my cardiology colleagues, Rita probably remembers, we're recommending this, we're pushing this very hard on patients for a number of years. Again, because the scientific evidence looked really good until we did the randomized trials. All right. I don't want to totally poo-poo this because this is one vitamin that I recommend routinely to all my women of childbearing age. There's unequivocal evidence, again from randomized trials, that folate actually prevents a kind of birth defect, a neural tube defects. The worst kind is anencephaly. The brain doesn't form. But folic acid is really important. A number of randomized trials demonstrate a dramatic reduction. And then, as I said, we now fortify flour in our country and a number of countries around the world. And since doing that, there's been a big reduction in overall rates of these neural tube defects, these devastating birth defects since doing it. So this is one vitamin that I do recommend, but only for a subset of people in the population, just to prevent neural tube defects. I recommend it for all women of childbearing age, in part because half of pregnancies are unplanned. So if you can have a kid, I think you should be taking folic acid. All right. I'm going to turn quickly to multivitamins, in part because that was one of the things that was in the news a couple of years ago. This is an observational study, a little less than 40,000 women, ages 55 to 69, followed for almost 20 years. And they showed that women who were taking multivitamins in this study actually had an increased risk of death. It was small, 6%, but statistically significant. But death is common in this group. So it actually it meant for every 42 women taking a multivitamin regularly, one died who shouldn't have, if this was causal. But again, this is an observational study. There were lots of other things that were associated with increased risk of death. So I'm not sure I believe it, but it certainly is, again, there's no reason to be taking a multivitamin. The evidence really doesn't support its use. There have been a number of randomized trials as well that have been essentially null. The only randomized trials of vitamins that have been positive have been in areas where there was significant nutritional deficiencies. So there's one big study out of China. There was a decrease in a number of cancers and an overall mortality, but that was in a part of the world where there were many dietary deficiencies, and so you needed to replace that. Again, adequate intakes to prevent diseases of deficiency like scurvy and beriberi and so on. Yes, we need that, but taking extra, especially in a country like the U.S. where we have problems where we eat too much, really not necessarily necessary and may be harmful. All right, so I'm going to turn to the now finally to something that's a little more topical, vitamin D. I like to talk about it as the nutrient of the year. This was back in 2009. You saw almost a doubling from 2008 to 2009 in the sales of vitamin D. So vitamin D is clearly important. Most of the women in the room have likely either had some discussion with their physicians about the importance for preventing osteoporosis, often in conjunction with calcium. But it's also been associated with less type 1 diabetes, less type 2 diabetes, less rheumatoid arthritis, less multiple sclerosis. You know, it's supposed to be the be all and end all of vitamins. Gonna, you know, so it took the place of antioxidants and homocysteine lowering therapy. It's the third wave of the vitamin that's going to prevent everything and make your life perfect. It is important to prevent rickets in children. I like to point out that it really is a hormone. You take in a certain form of it, but then it's activated by both the liver and the kidneys in two different steps, and that's tightly regulated by the body. And if you don't have enough calcium and phosphorus, the body upregulates the hormonal form of vitamin D, and you absorb more calcium and phosphorus. That lowers a hormone called parathyroid hormone. Normally, if you have high levels of parathyroid hormone, that tells the bone to break down and release calcium and phosphorus, because the body needs calcium to do lots of things, for muscle function, for nerve function, and so on. So taking adequate vitamin D to keep your PTH low helps to prevent osteoporosis. So definitely a good thing. Calcium is important for muscular function. In fact, there's good evidence that vitamin D prevents falls, probably through muscular function. And vitamin D actually gets into the nucleus of cells, binds to DNA, and affects the regulation of about 10%. So like over 2,000 genes in the human genome are partially regulated by vitamin D. So it may do a lot more things than regulate calcium and phosphorus metabolism. So lots of excitement about it. The Institute of Medicine is the group that essentially makes recommendations about daily allowances of vitamins, among many other things. And they recently reviewed, not so recently now, a couple of years ago, re-reviewed all the literature, over 1,000 studies, looking at a number of different health outcomes because of all the excitement about vitamin D. And I'll talk a little bit about that. And they updated their 1997 recommendations. And I'll talk a little bit about their recommendations. Basic recommendation for most of us ages 1 through 70, about 600 international units a day is fine. Over 70, we don't absorb it quite as well. We need a little bit more. So they say 800 international units, and that pretty much should be enough vitamin D for everybody unless you have a problem absorbing fat-soluble vitamins. So if you have celiac disease, you've had surgery for weight loss that affects absorption of vitamins, then you may need some more. But those are the exceptions. For the general population, this is plenty. But we know that vitamin D levels are low in the U.S. This is nationally representative data that's collected regularly in the United States, a series of studies called NHANES, National Health and Nutrition Examination Study. So it gives us data that's representative of the entire U.S. And we know that for adult women, that actually they're about 1 in 10 is at what the Institute of Medicine calls at risk of deficiency. So this is really low, where everybody agrees we should have some more. So that's less than 12 nanograms per milliliter. Those are the units that are reported here in the U.S. So about 1 in 10 women or so are at risk of deficiency. About a third are at risk of inadequacy. So the Institute of Medicine suggests that we should be above 20 to really have adequate vitamin D to prevent osteoporosis or optimally prevent osteoporosis. Again, looking at the sum total of the literature in 2010, 2011. My endocrinology colleagues actually say, optimal vitamin D levels are greater than 30, and until recently, that was the normal level reported at UCSF, and anything less than 30 was considered low. So about 8 out of 10 women are below 30. So there is at least a substantial minority of women who are low, and according to the endocrinologists anyways, suboptimal. This is mostly based on PTH levels. It turns out that parathyroid hormone continues to go down as vitamin D levels go from 20 to 30. So they think, optimally protect the bone, maximally protect the bone, you should be at 30 or higher. But the evidence in terms of fractures, preventing hip fractures, spine fractures, the things we really care about with osteoporosis, above 20 is probably fine. So why do we have so little D? Well, it turns out the body makes vitamin D from sunlight. So we actually don't take vitamin D in. We have cholesterol precursors in the skin. Ultraviolet light hits it. The body changes that to vitamin D, and that's how we normally make it. But of course, we tell you, don't go out in the sun. You're going to get skin cancer, and it's ultraviolet light that causes skin cancer. And SPF 8 is enough to block all vitamin D synthesis. If you're in a car, behind the just the glass that's in car windows, that blocks out the UV light enough that you don't make vitamin D. You wear clothes, no vitamin D. Clothes and hats, what we tell you to wear when you go out in the sun, you don't make vitamin D. So that's part of the reason. We just don't get outside in the sunlight the way we used to. Not only that, the sun isn't strong enough in the winter. From San Francisco north or from Brasilia south in the winter to make adequate vitamin D, even if you're outside with your shirt off in the wintertime, freezing to death. The sun just isn't strong enough. So there are seasonal variations, and I'll show you a little bit of that with one of the studies that I'm going to show you. So how do we get vitamin D? Do what your grandma said. Take some cod liver oil. It's actually very rich in vitamin D. We fortify milk with it, with both calcium and vitamin D, so a great way to help to prevent osteoporosis. Eggs have a little bit. Fatty fishes have quite a bit. We also fortify orange juice with vitamin D. And mushrooms, interestingly, particularly more exotic forms, but even the button mushrooms, if they're exposed to a lot of ultraviolet light, they actually can be quite high in vitamin D, so a great source. This is a little wonky, but sometimes people are interested in this. There are actually two forms of vitamin D you'll see on labels and things like that. Vitamin D2 or ergocalciferol used to be the form that was in most supplements. It's the form that plants make, including mushrooms. And it really works effectively for us when we take it in. But that's not the form that our skin makes. Our skin makes a slight variation, vitamin D3. Again, they both work effectively in terms of being converted to a vitamin, the hormonal form that regulates calcium metabolism. But D3 is more natural, and actually because of that and the marketing in the supplement industry, now most supplements actually are vitamin D3, so you're aware of that. So should we be recommending supplements? The data are really quite confusing. Even when we're looking at preventing fractures, which is the area where there's the most evidence, this is a little bit old. There have been a couple of studies since, but really the conclusions haven't changed. This was something actually was part of work we did for the California Technology Assessment Forum. We looked at this. At that point, there were 25 randomized trials, so not observational studies, randomized trials of vitamin D looking at broken bones, which is what we're trying to prevent. It was a tremendous variation in these studies. So some of the studies, the average age was 53. In other studies, the average age was 85. And again, for studies where you're trying to prevent fractures, especially the fractures due to weak bones, osteoporotic fractures, they happen in older people. So many of the studies focused on older people, but there's been a lot of interest in the benefits starting earlier, hence some of the studies starting with an average age of 53. In some of the studies, they just looked at people in nursing homes. Again, frail, elderly, at very high risk for hip fractures. Others looked at people living independently in the community. Some had had hip fractures before. Some had never had a fracture. So those are the variations, a tremendous amount of variation in the types of individuals studied in these 25 trials. There was also a lot of difference in the vitamin D that was studied. Some used 300 international units a day. Some gave 500,000 international units, but once a day. It's a fat-soluble vitamin. So it turns out once a year. A year later, your vitamin D level is still well above 30, actually. So it's effective given that way. And when you're thinking about, it's easy. Take one big pill or an injection once a year, you're done. In the nursing home, it's much easier to do that than to have to give these pills every day. So a lot of variation in the studies. And sometimes they gave calcium and sometimes they didn't. And that's important because the real way that vitamin D works, or at least the primary way we think for preventing osteoporosis, is tells the body to absorb calcium. If the body absorbs calcium, then the brain says, I don't need to steal the calcium from the bones, so the bones are protected. They don't get weaker and you don't get fractures. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples here. The first trial published in the New England Journal, our most influential journal in the United States. This was one of the ones done in nursing homes, 180 nursing homes in France. So these trials are expensive and not simple to do. They gave 800 international units a day, and that's what the Institute of Medicine says people over the age of 70 should take in. So 800 international units a day of D3, the human form, plus some calcium every day, and they compared it to placebo. Dramatic reduction in hip fractures, 5% versus 7%, meets our criteria for statistically significant. We believe this is real, not a chance finding. And also other important fractures, non-vertebral fractures overall. There was also a reduction in vertebral fractures. So lots of excitement, everybody should do it. 2010, the Journal of the American Medical Association, this was women over the age of 70 in Australia who had risk factors for hip fracture, a little over 2,000 women. This is the study where they gave 500,000 units once a day. They didn't give once a year, no calcium, but this is like 1,400 international units a day. So plenty, more than that 800 international unit minimum. And they actually saw an increase in both falls and fractures. I haven't shown the other. There's a lot of literature showing that daily vitamin D plus calcium decreases the risk of falling, which may be part of how it prevents fractures. So the exact opposite of what the first trial found. So very confusing. So why the variation? There are statistical ways to try and tease this out, but essentially it seemed to vary whether or not you got calcium. So the studies where you got calcium, there was benefit. Without calcium, there wasn't benefit. It didn't matter the age of the people. Some of the trials included men. It didn't matter whether or not men were included. It didn't matter what the starting vitamin D level was. It didn't matter what kind of vitamin D, D2 or D3. It really seemed to be whether or not you got calcium with it. Turned out, though, that all of the studies that included calcium did this on a daily basis. So it may be something about the less frequent high dose that matters. And in fact, that one trial, they went back and looked and showed that the excess risk of falls and fractures happened in the first 3 months after that big dose, and then it went back down to baseline. And there was just another study published this year with every 3 month dosing that also showed an increase in falls. So there may be something bad about getting a whole lot of vitamin D at once, that may actually affect things in a bad way, and it may be better to be getting it every day. So if you put it all together, if you have vitamin D plus calcium, that seems to reduce the risk of fractures. About 18% for hip fractures, which is the most serious osteoporotic fracture, about 14% for all fractures. So appears to be a real phenomenon. This is from randomized trials, but randomized trials that had vitamin D plus calcium. And it works the best in the people who are at high risk for fractures. So older folks, people who've had prior fractures, people who don't have a lot of vitamin D to begin with. The harms are uncommon, but there are some concerns about calcium, which I guess I'm not, I'll talk about it in a minute. There's some concerns about calcium and heart disease that are controversial. And that means, again, you really probably want to do this only in people at higher risk for fracture. Right now, with the concerns about some potential harms, it doesn't make sense if you're at very low risk for an osteoporotic fracture to be doing this when there are uncertainties about some harms. And we'll come to that again in a minute. But as I was saying, vitamin D is the new panacea. In observational studies, it reduces colon cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, pancreatic cancer, reduces cardiovascular disease, reduces multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis. People get less flus, less colds, there's less chronic pain, and it seems to reduce total mortality. So here's a study from what's now JAMA Internal Medicine looking at all-cause mortality. So this, just to orient you, this is the risk of dying. Higher is a higher risk of dying. This is the vitamin D level. And they showed that people with low vitamin D levels were more likely to die, and that continued to come down until you got to that magic 30 that the endocrinologists like, and then it sort of flattens out. Maybe it goes up again, but a lot of uncertainty here. Most people focused here in observational studies, people with low levels of vitamin D died more often than those with healthier levels of vitamin D. And actually, there's some data, if you actually look at the randomized trials, vitamin D alone didn't affect mortality, but again, in that magical combination of vitamin D plus calcium, there was a modest reduction of 9%, but a 1 in 11 chance of dying, preventing it with a simple intervention, that seems pretty good. That was statistically significant, so suggestive that this may be a real phenomenon. Some of the other things, this is an example of the colds and flus. And it's broken out by season because in the winter, you get more colds and flus, and also your vitamin D levels are lower than in the summer. So you see seasonal variation. But if you look at the white bars are those with low levels of vitamin D. The gray are intermediate, and the darkest bars are high levels of vitamin D. And you see in the winter, there are fewer colds in those with higher levels of vitamin D. And you see the same thing in the summer. The absolute risk is lower because we get less colds and flus in the summer than we do in the winter. But observational data, again, suggestive of a reduction in colds and flus. So we did a randomized trial. Not a big one, 322 people followed for 18 months. They got monthly vitamin D in this study. And it worked. Their vitamin D levels went up to 48 from 25. But the incidence of colds and flus over that 18 months, there were 3.7 in those who over the 18 months in those who got vitamin D, and 3.7 in those who got placebo. So absolutely no effect of giving the vitamin D. So again, this slide where you see people with higher levels of vitamin D getting less colds and flus, it's probably just because they have a healthier lifestyle. It has nothing to do with the vitamin D. So again, always be cautious when leaping from observational studies to, oh, this is going to help me. So the randomized trial showed absolutely no benefit. So the answer here is still open. As I show, we've done a lot of studies, and it's confusing even for fractures. For general health, we really don't know yet. But people are really interested in this. There's a lot of excitement about it. So there are four trials, most of them with 20 to 25,000 people agreeing to be randomized to vitamin D or a placebo. And they're mostly following people for 5 years. A couple of different doses, but the average dose is around 2,000 international units a day of the D3. And these, we should have results next year in 2017. We're going to have five-year results for lots of different health outcomes. So we're going to know a tremendous amount about vitamin D. Interestingly, none of these use calcium. It's all vitamin D. So if these turn out to be null, there's still going to be an open question about whether there's benefit when given in combination with calcium. So what about calcium? So it does a lot. It's important for iron transportation, iron transport across membranes, which is fundamental to the transmission of signals in the nerve. It's fundamental for your muscles to contract. It's important for blood pressure regulation. You know, use calcium channel blockers to treat blood pressure. It's important for blood clotting. They need calcium for the clotting cascade to work. It's important for secretion of a lot of things, hormones, digestive enzymes, neurotransmitters, activates a lot of enzymes. So very diverse use of calcium in the body, very important. That same Institute of Medicine report looked at calcium as well as vitamin D because they're so tightly linked. And here are the RDAs, about 1,000 milligrams a day, a little bit more when you're growing bones, a little bit more when we're older because we don't absorb it as well. But I didn't put pregnant women also need extra because they're building the bones of the kids. And most women don't take enough in, though it's also hard to take. We start to get kidney stones, we get a lot of GI upset. It's not an easy mineral to take in, and you get up to just twice the what's recommended and you start to get toxicity. So we have to be careful about it. And there was a study that looked at all the randomized trials of calcium supplements with or without vitamin D, and they showed an increase in MIs, which is heart attacks, doctor speak for heart attack, myocardial infarction. So they, when you lump together all the heart attacks and strokes, there was a statistically significant increase. This is controversial because the studies weren't designed to look at strokes and heart attacks. My osteoporosis colleagues don't believe this, but to my mind, it gives me pause, and I'm certainly anxious about recommending high-dose calcium supplements because strokes and heart attacks are catastrophic, and compared to osteoporotic fractures. So again, this is part of the reason why I don't recommend this strongly for everybody for sort of routine use. But as people get older, they're at higher risk for osteoporosis, particularly if we measure bone density using that DEXA scan, this measure of bone density. If you're low, then I might recommend the vitamin D and calcium supplementation. So my take-home point, from here, vitamin D insufficiency is common, and we probably want to get people up to an adequate level. I didn't talk about this here, but the blood test is something called 25-hydroxyvitamin D. This is sort of the storage form in the body, best reflects your overall intake and store of vitamin D. And in observational studies, clearly predicts falls and fractures. To replete this, 800 international units a day is fine, and probably everybody should just take that. And that's what now most multivitamins, if you take a multivitamin, particularly the ones marketed to over 50, they'll have 800 international units of vitamin D, and that's probably fine. We probably don't need to measure vitamin D. It's an expensive test, and most of us probably need a little extra. So this is the one vitamin that I recommend that everybody take a little bit of, because we don't get out in the sun to make enough of it. And so that's getting us up, that's fixing the insufficiency, but taking excess we don't know about. And again, I would wait until these randomized trials. We should have information within a year or so to answer whether we all should be taking higher doses of vitamin D. I want you to get plenty of calcium, but I prefer foods over supplements. I'm concerned about the supplement issue. It may be that when you take a big dose of calcium, you get a bump in calcium in your blood, that makes your blood clot a little easier, and that leads to strokes and heart attacks. Calcium is clearly important for clotting, and it may be that this sort of big bump in calcium is associated with that. That's hand-waving. I don't know that that's the case, but I'm concerned by the data enough that I encourage my patients as much as possible, eat sardines, which have little bones in them and thus have calcium in them. Drink your milk, have a low-fat latte in the morning. Get your calcium as much as possible from yogurt and milk products and things like that, and minimize supplements. If you need supplements, certainly people are lactose intolerant. Then space it out and have smaller supplements is my recommendation. And keep watching the literature, because it's an area of great controversy and ongoing studies. I should say there was a vitamin D randomized trial published published officially tomorrow in JAMA, looking at it for osteoarthritis of the knee, where they did, I think even MRIs, but if not, then plain films, and looked at the thickness of cartilage. And it was all done in people who had low levels of vitamin D to start off with. So they started with people who were deficient, randomized them to vitamin D or not, no benefit. So it didn't prevent. So yet another negative study. There have been a number just this year. So it's an area of ongoing research, and we're going to have a lot more data. All right. In the last couple of minutes of the talk before we get to questions, I'm going to talk about omega-3 fatty acids, because this is something else that my cardiology colleagues are still recommending, less so than they were before. There was great observational data, interesting data from the 40s and 50s, who went up to Greenland. These Eskimos, they eat this terrible diet, super high in fat. They don't eat any fruits and vegetables, and yet they don't get heart disease. Why is that? And it turns out the fish they eat, these oily cold water fish, they're high in these omega-3 fatty acids. I can't pronounce them, so I just call them EPA and DHA. Those are the beneficial ones. And the people who eat a lot of those, we see they get less fatal and non-fatal cardiovascular events, meaning less strokes and heart attacks. And in observational studies, eating one or two servings of fish a week reduced the risk of strokes and heart attacks by more than a third. And total mortality was lower as well. How much? So the American Heart Association, I think their most recent guidelines still say this. Healthy people, eat one or two servings a week of either fish or plant-based sources of the omega-3s, like flax seeds and nuts and things like that. And people with heart disease, they actually were recommending a supplement. But what's the data? There was one Italian trial early on that showed remarkable benefits in people who'd had a heart attack. But all of the recent trials in the best journals in the world show not even a trend towards benefit in people who'd had a heart attack, people who had known cardiovascular disease, people with atrial fibrillation. And it's supposed to prevent inflammation as well. So they studied it in patients in the ICU who had damage to their lungs, requiring an artificial breathing tube and a machine to breathe for them. In that trial, there was there was clear harm. The people randomized to the omega-3 fatty acids were in the ICU 3 days longer, And there was a trend towards an increase in total mortality. It wasn't statistically significant. It wasn't less than 0.05, but it was close. So again, the exact opposite of what we thought from our understanding of the biology. Again, a lot of basic science stuff done in cell lines, in test tubes, in animal models, suggested that this would be beneficial, and it was actually harmful. Thankfully, in medicine, the thing that's really advanced medicine over the last 50 years is we do lots of randomized trials now. We figure out what works and what doesn't, and that really helps to guide therapy, and that's why we've made such great progress. So there's a meta-analysis of the randomized trial. I didn't really explain meta-analyses, but it's a statistical way to combine the information from a number of different studies. And ideally, you can combine observational studies, but again, I've been trying to drive home the point that, you know, observational studies are hypothesis generating. If you really want to know whether it's causal, whether these vitamins are beneficial, you need to do randomized trials, experiments where half get it, half don't. Nobody knows until the study is done who got the active treatment and who got the placebo. So for the fatty acid, for omega-3 fatty acids, 20,000 patients who already had known cardiovascular disease, some variation in the dosing and the follow-up, but no benefits, no harms. There wasn't any trend towards harm. I don't actively dissuade patients from taking this. They lower triglycerides. There may be some small benefits in subpopulations, but overall, I really don't think there's been a significant benefit. And if my patients have any financial challenges, I say, don't waste your money here. Spend it on the gym membership or seeing a dietitian. Buy better food. Eat the Mediterranean diet. Spend your money there, not on the supplements. So in summary, in the modern era of medical therapy for vascular disease, and really this means in the era of statins. So I think the big difference from the one trial that showed benefit, back then nobody was on statins after heart attacks. Now everybody who has a heart attack is put on a statin. And I think there's no benefit to the omega-3 fatty acids in those patients. It may be in people who are not on statin therapy, there may be some small benefits. But there doesn't seem to be any significant harm. So again, I don't dissuade people. Overall, my bottom line is beta carotene, don't do it, harmful. Vitamin E, don't do it, harmful. Folate, as I said, women of childbearing age, yes. Vitamin D plus calcium, yes, a weak yes. But really, I want to target people at high risk for fractures. So I don't want everybody to do this yet. I think the data are still unclear. Omega-3s, no benefit, so I don't recommend it. So in general, less is more. Don't do it. Eat a healthy diet. Eat enough to avoid deficiency. Don't take pills to do this. Eat a good variety of food, like Michael Pollan says. I think eating real food, not too much, mostly plants. Maybe some fish. That's what I would recommend. And here in the Bay Area, we're spoiled. We have the best produce in the world. We have access to everything. Do that. Don't fill yourself up with supplements. And with that, I'm happy to take questions.
Any thoughts on Ocuvite?
On Ocuvite? So this is a combination that's supposed to help prevent macular degeneration. There's some studies suggesting a benefit there. They're pretty small. I know most of the ophthalmologists are recommending it now. Doesn't seem to be harmful. I don't think the data are fully robust yet. Most of these are designed to dissolve. So most of you, you know, if you take a multivitamin, you know, some of the B vitamins turn your urine a little orange yellow. I mean, most of these are pretty effective. So I don't think there's a big advantage. If you have trouble, if you see the pills in your stool, yes. And some people do have trouble. Some people have very fast transit. Some people don't have enough acid to digest some of the ones. Some are designed to be digested partly by acid. So yes, in some cases. But again, for the most part, I don't think you need to take a powder or a pill. So, question.
So I can't understand how Linus Pauling could do so. Did I say Linus Pauling?
Yeah.
Linus Pauling could be so wrong because didn't he
2 Nobel Prizes, not just one. Just being smart, you know, you can fool. We fool ourselves all the time in medicine. We think we understand the biology, and the body turns out to be more complicated than that. I mean, he understood. He was a chemist. He understood the chemistry. He saw the way it worked in test tube models of things, and he was convinced it was beneficial. It was before we did these big randomized trials, so he died before seeing the definitive studies of vitamin C. The story is a little bit more complicated than I've made it out to be. There are a few examples where vitamin C actually seems to be helpful. So in people who are running marathons, in military folks who are doing big missions in the Arctic where they're stressing the body hugely, they actually get fewer colds in that situation. That's one place where yes, it actually did prevent colds. But most of the randomized trials in healthy, free-living individuals who aren't stressing themselves to a serious degree, absolutely no difference in the rates of colds and flus taking vitamin C versus not vitamin C. But there is a lot of basic science that suggests that there should be. But I give a talk to first-year medical students where I'm introducing how to interpret studies and read the medical literature. And I give a couple of examples of things that I was taught at UCSF here that we now do the exact opposite. So heart failure, that the heart's not pumping very well. So the medicine's called beta blockers. They decrease the squeeze of the heart. So I was taught never give beta blockers to patients with heart failure. You are going to make their heart failure worse. You're going to put them in the hospital. Terrible thing to do. What do we do in 2016? Somebody gets heart failure, you stabilize them, you start them on a beta blocker, you get them on the highest dose possible. It cuts the risk of dying by a third. So we had understanding from really good science and dog models where you did all kinds of experiments and stuff. Well, you know, we thought we understood and we were wrong. I was taught give every postmenopausal woman hormone therapy. Why? Not because of menopausal symptoms, and all was to prevent heart disease. All of the observational studies showed dramatic decrease in heart disease in women who were given estrogen plus progestins. When we did the randomized trials, there's an increase in strokes and heart attacks, not a decrease. So, and it wasn't that, you know, the science was bad, it was wrong, but, you know, and there were a lot of really good studies showing that estrogen plus progestin, it lowers bad cholesterol and increases vascular reactivity. There was a lot of reasons to think it should be beneficial. In addition to the, there was mechanistic data, animal model data, human data, and yet we were wrong. We still learn. So Linus Pauling, just the science hadn't advanced enough. He had rationale for it. It wasn't like he was a huckster. He believed it, and there was good science behind it, but it wasn't randomized trials in large numbers of people, which we really needed to sort this out. Yeah, I mean, the nutritionist, like said, I'm not convinced that that's really, that there's something special about food. I think we need a lot of different micronutrients and vitamins. We need enough to prevent deficiency. We need enough so that the chemistry of the body can work. I mean, folate provides a methyl group, a single carbon group. Vitamin B12 takes that in a bunch of reactions. It gets passed to B12 and then gets stuck wherever the body needs it. So it's lots of complicated chemistry. I don't think there's anything magical about getting that from kale versus getting it in a pill, but I think it's absolutely fine to get it from kale, and we don't understand enough of the biology, and we should just do what sort of nature designed us to do, was mostly eating fruits and vegetables that were around and a little bit of protein. And that's probably the best way. There have been some randomized trials. The one that's gotten the most press is this trial in Spain where they randomized people to a Mediterranean diet. And of course, they were already sort of eating a Mediterranean diet, but they really pushed extra olive oil or nuts, where they gave them they got like 2 liters a week of olive oil, something like huge amounts of olive oil were actually given to them, sponsored by an olive oil company. And similarly, a nut producer gave all of the nuts because one arm got a lot of olive oil, one got a lot of nuts, and then the others just got sort of routine advice. But they were really pushed to have a Mediterranean diet, and those on the Mediterranean diet had less strokes, less heart attacks, less diabetes, less breast cancer now, better preserved cognitive function. So this is a diet, this is a mix of diets that's been studied in a randomized trial and seems to help. And it's sort of interesting in that it's actually rich in a fair amount of fat, because nuts have a lot of fat, of oil, of fats in them. So this is not a low-fat diet, but it really seemed to prevent a lot of the diseases of aging that we care about. So, and it's a reasonable, healthy diet. They promoted a lot of tomato sauce. This, the Spanish version, they actually use a lot of onions in it as well. The sofrito, that's the basis of a lot of the cuisine that they sort of pushed in this Mediterranean diet. But, you know, so that's another element that probably lots of nuts, lots of olive oil, you know, in your mix of Michael Pollan-style diet, that's probably, you know, the best data in terms of a really good study of an overall diet. It's impossible, as you say, to kale versus spinach. We're never going to be able to do that and tease that out. But I think it really doesn't matter. I think you want to eat a variety of foods, different colors, different types of foods, to make sure you're getting a variety of nutrients. And most of us in the United States get plenty of the low levels of selenium and, you know, and calcium and things like that we need, as well as the different vitamins. And that's probably the healthiest way to do it. We may be able to eventually tease out, you know, the super element, the resveratrol or something that's going to make us all live to be 120 before we get any illnesses. But we're a long way from that right now. And again, I think eating a balanced diet, Mediterranean style, Michael Pollan style, is where the best evidence is right now. Question.
Have you looked at the intake of small tablets of aspirin? Seems that for the longest time there was a series of studies that says aspirin does this and that, everything's good, even for healthy people.
Yeah, I mean, it's still controversial. It was just yet another analysis of it. I mean, I think it's a double-edged sword. I think there's pretty good evidence from randomized trials that we prevent some of the colon polyps and eventually prevent some colon cancers. So that's one benefit. The other benefit is it decreases clotting in the blood and prevents heart attacks in men and strokes in women. It seems to act a little bit differently in men and women. But it's also got downsides. It increases the risk of strokes where you bleed. Those are less common than the clotting ones, but that's a real harm. It also increases the risks of ulcers, and if you get an ulcer that bleeds, you don't clot as well, so you can have a very serious bleed from that. So there are harms as well. So again, it's one of those things where there are harms and benefits, and you have to weigh it. And you certainly don't recommend 30-year-olds take an aspirin a day, because they're at very low risk of strokes and heart attacks, and they're more likely to have harms from it. People who get to a higher level of risk or strokes and heart attacks, probably the benefits start to outweigh the risks. Dr. Redberg probably has a slightly different take on this, but my sense actually is that the harms of the statin therapy are actually less than the harms of aspirin, and so it may make more sense. I see she's shaking her head no. that it may be make more sense to start with statins rather than aspirin in terms of first-line prevention, when you're talking about preventing heart attacks in particular, which is mostly what we're trying to prevent with aspirin. Though maybe now with the increasing levels of evidence about preventing colon cancer as well, we may be swayed. But it's still controversial, and there are definitely harms to it. So you shouldn't do it lightly. You should really think about, you know, if you have already had ulcers, bleeding risks, you know, the harms may outweigh the benefits. So the question is benefits for infants and children. I haven't seen a lot of, I haven't seen, for instance, randomized trials. Certainly, infants and children are building bones. They need some extra vitamin D and calcium. Again, probably better to get it from, you know, natural foods if possible, but it's an area where there may be benefit, particularly for fast-growing adolescents when building bone, to have a little extra vitamin D and calcium. I'm a general internist. I don't know the pediatric literature as well, so I take that with a little bit of a grain of salt. you know, there's more and more evidence about longevity and this whole sirtuin pathway, which in animals seems to be associated with longevity. The amount of resveratrol in red wine that you need to achieve the amounts used in the rat and mice models is like 150 bottles a day of wine. So it's way more than we're getting. So it's clearly you can't get it from natural forms. There are companies that have tried to synthesize more potent forms that act on the same metabolic pathways. And those studies are in clinical trials. They clearly didn't hit the ball out of the park because the studies were started a couple of years ago and they haven't been announced yet. So I don't think the findings have been as promising as they had touted to their potential investors when forming the companies and stuff. So I think this is one of those areas to watch. I think there's clearly something in the sort of pathways associated with starvation that turn on systems in the body that help to prevent cancer and heart disease and stuff. But whether the current generation of supplements actually are beneficial, I think we're in the era of where we were early on in the antioxidants and other things. It makes sense. We have some biological plausibility. We have some data suggesting benefit, but the right dose and whether the balance of benefits and harms, are there unexpected harms that we don't anticipate right now? We just don't know. And again, the body regulates things very locally. And so when we give things to the whole body, we often have unanticipated side effects. Even with our targeted chemotherapy, you have this system that's deranged in breast cancer, so overexpression of growth factor on the cancer. So we have Herceptin and second generation things that target that receptor and should just kill those cancers. But it turns out heart muscle also expresses that, and so you get heart damage from it. So yeah. But the body is complicated and often very local, and so even targeted therapy sometimes isn't as targeted as we want, particularly when we give it in a pill form or into the blood. We're not delivering it locally, and sometimes to get those kind of benefits, we need it just locally. It's exciting. Lots of people are looking at that and related areas. Longevity research is a huge area right now in basic science and in clinical science, but we don't know yet about the relative benefits and harms. So the question is organic foods versus non-organic foods. Is there any data on the quality of the nutrients and so on? There's some data. I think a lot of it is more linked to pesticide exposure and things like that. And so you're avoiding some of the harmful chemicals, I think, is probably the main benefit. I fight with my wife on this. She likes to spend money on it. I think it's oversold. I think it's overhyped. There's small benefits, but I think the main benefits are sort of avoiding the toxicity associated with the chemicals, the environmental benefits of not using chemicals to grow the food and so on. The incremental health value of that is probably pretty small. All right. Great. Thanks very much for all your questions.